Hello, hello, everyone. So I'm Rachel Delacour, and I'm trying to give you that first year, you know, a view about what I've been through and what was important to do, what to get good at, and what to absolutely ignore some of. So, okay. Allo, allo? It doesn't work. Okay, cool. I started the first company called Byme Analytics, and it was all about cloud business intelligence. And we've started it, this company in 2009. And by 2015, so we've been acquired by Zendesk, that you, I guess, all know. And by this time, you know, I was pregnant of my second child in this picture. And it's a time where I've worked at Zendesk. It was great, but it's also a time where I thought that post-acquisition, I put my family in a safe place, okay, because of money. And actually, I've read my first IPCC report in a plane while flying, not kidding. And I just understood that I put absolutely no one of my family in a safe place. So I had to try to do something, to do my part. And I started to tap into the portfolio of former customers I had at Byme Analytics, but also at Zendesk, interviewing those CEOs, okay? And they just told me, Rachel, I was asking them, what are you doing, guys, to save the planet, to make sure that your carbon emissions are on track, etc., because the world is being completely derailed. And they told me, you know what, we just don't know where to start. And the more they were talking to me, you know, the more we understood that actually carbon was a data and a network problem. They just did not know where to start. And they were actually asking us to do BI, business intelligence, you know, for carbon. So we started that company in 2020, Sweep. Now we are 80 people. And at Sweep, actually, yeah, we are it's a software platform, and we are helping businesses to track and act on their carbon so they can become forever companies. They can really transition to this low carbon world. But it's I'm not here to talk to you about Sweep, but still, you know, in this journey, so it's pretty small figures, but in this journey through Byme, through Zendesk, through Sweep, in figures, this is what I have been through. So I've been through, you know, I started my first company during the pure subprime crisis. Not easy, but actually it's kind of pretty cool to start during a crisis. You know, you're focusing on the essential. At Zendesk, you know, I was in this, the first year I was at Zendesk, I was, witnessing, you know, from the inside, a post-IPO company, an hyper-growth company, you know, in Silicon Valley-based style, etc. At Sweep, I started, you know, in this recession coming, you know, time as well. In terms of fundraising, I've been through six fundraising, three at Byme, three at Sweep. For a total raised of 5 plus 100 million by myself and my co-founders. And at Zendesk, I've been through, you know, those, it's not fundraising, but I've witnessed also from the inside what it is to prepare an earning call when you are post-IPO, you know. And I can tell you that it's the energy of 10 fundraisings when you are preparing this, so much stress. And in terms of, so I made one exit for 45 million by being acquired by Zendesk. And of course, I plan to do an IPO at Sweep. This is what I wish for my team for Climtech in general, to broadcast that message. And from an employee standpoint, I've been from an environment of 45 people at Byme. Then at Zendesk with thousands of employees, and at Sweep, you know, in a year, you know, 80 people. So yeah, so we've been navigating, you know, those environments with my co-founders. And from a go-to-market standpoint, I've been through an environment of B2B SaaS, very transactional business model. at Zendesk, transactional but moving up market when I joined them. And at Sweep, right away, so still B2B, SaaS, but right away in an enterprise size, you know, enterprise-y business model, targeting those enterprises. And from an office, you know, location standpoint, at BIM, we were very, you know, traditional world. We have to all work in the same room. So we had one office in France, one in the US. But I also discovered, even before COVID, that while joining Zendesk, that an hybrid environment, you know, could work also. And at Sweep, we made, because we've started during the lockdown, we had to set up our team for being purely remote, you know. And today we are on 3 continents, but we are also getting back to an hybrid model with offices in London, Paris, and Montpellier. So this is what I have been through as an entrepreneur so far. And if I have to tell you my experience, you know, about what to focus on, what to do, at least in year one. So definitely, in year one, speak about your business, your idea, absolutely to everyone. I'm showing this driver here, but even the driver of your Uber or else, you absolutely have to, your former coworkers, you have to spread the word of about what you are doing. Everyone is telling you this already. There is no, it's all about execution, etc. It's definitely true. Definitely true. So tell about that to get as much feedback as possible. And during this first year, I definitely, so they are my co-founders, and I definitely recommend you to share the load and be sure that you are starting your business being several co-founders. It definitely helped first to triangulate with people who are willing to disagree. But it's also good for the complementary team, you know, from a gender standpoint, of course, this is great. And most importantly, when the female is the CEO. And yes, it's enriching your experience, you know. In this picture, we are two above 40 years old and two who are in their 30s. And I can tell you that from a dynamic standpoint, it's really interesting when you are speaking with customers, when we are hiring employees. It's really great. So, and you are really sharing the loads and the concerns and the stress, etc. During this first year also, try to start at 100% of your time. I am seeing too many founders who are still working, you know. I know it's difficult. I know it's difficult to give up on a salary, okay, when you are starting, but the sooner you see results for yourself, you know, for your own motivation, the better it is. Because don't waste too much time. Try to make the most of this momentum of motivation. And if it means that you have to be back to your parents' house because you can't pay rent, then accept to do this. I have done this, and you know what? I've done that, and I returned to my parents-in-law, you know, house, okay? And when you are almost 30 years old, I can tell you that it hurts, but at least we start full time. So also when you are setting up the foundation, okay, there is one with, voilà. When you are setting up that first year, when you are setting up the foundations, it's absolutely critical that you think about your future, of course. And in our case, you know, it was all about saying, okay, what company, who do we want to be? Which kind of companies do we want to manage, you know, through time? And for us, it was super important to chase that B Corp logo, just to be sure that we were putting the company on the right, you know, track, because we know that we will win, you know, that we will be a fantastic, you know, SAP or Salesforce of everything related to extra financial, you know, through time. But we could also become a jerk through time, okay? So at least we try to prevent the fact that even if we are making too much money, we are on the right guidelines. And it's super important also to choose the right equity story. So your equity story counts. It counts to get access to the right customers. It counts to you have to enjoy, okay, meeting with your financial partners. They have to help you on all the different faces of your business. So I don't know if Pia is here, but we have the best. So 2050, New Wave, La Familia, Balderton, Tony Fadell, and Coach as well. And during this first year, and I wanted to mention that, you know, keep super cool at trying to find a name, you know, don't over-engineer it, because, you know, the first company, we were super frustrated with my co-founder to not be a rock band. And we said, okay, let's at least please ourselves with a name that we find that's super cool. We are cloud. But actually, it was so bad from an SEO standpoint. So the company must be the same name of the product that you are selling, or it's super messy. And so, voilà, don't over-engineer it. But you absolutely have to spend money at first when you are finding a name. You must spend money on IP checks. It's super important because I can tell you that for my two companies, fortunately, I was really well, you know, if I had the good counsel for that. But when you are starting to raise funds, when you start to, you know, communicate about your brand, there is always people coming at your doors trying to get what they can from the name. At some point, they have registers or else. Be super careful, because if it's not done the right way early on, you can really mess with all the marketing you've done, all the positionings. You know, it's really important. So don't save money on that. And from just for yourself, you know, that first year, you have to track what matters to you, you know, to show progress to you first. And don't confuse, because I know that there is this hype about being an entrepreneur, but don't confuse the company goals with your desires, okay? So it's super important to be aware and conscious of that. And that first year as well, so it's plenty of recommendation, but that first year as well, what you have to do, it's, so back to the lawyer IP, to check your IP, but from a general standpoint, you absolutely must to choose your lawyer carefully. A good lawyer is expensive, but it's really important. I thought, to be honest, that all lawyers were the same, but like good restaurants, you know, there is a bad restaurant and bad lawyers too. And one of them, the first one, super cheap, super junior of the first company, I was just thinking that I was thinking some boxes, okay, we'll do the corporate, but he definitely almost crashed the company, okay? We couldn't raise funds. It was a nightmare. So be sure to spend the right money also here. And start also to understand that everything is forgiven when you have a revenue traction, okay? So don't wait to execute as much as you can. And when you start to have also during that first year, those first customer, okay? Because there will be plenty of people, also your VCs, okay, telling you that you should do that from a product standpoint, or the competition is doing this, etc. You must accept, at least this is my recommendation, it worked for us, you must accept the feedback, the product feedbacks from people who are already paying, okay? There will be an army of prospects who will tell you, ah, if you are doing this, I will pay you. Or if you will add that kind of features, yeah, certainly. No, okay? So accept feedbacks only from people who start to pay, okay? Who started to pay. And I put this picture as well about, that first year when it comes to recruit people, or if during that first year you have to establish, you know, because of the geography of your customers in another area compared to where you're living, for example, as a founders, be super creative. You can be super creative. And in our case, you know, we tried to be the big fish in town. We didn't have lots of money. But when we started very quickly when we started this US, you know, office, we went super local, and instead of picking New York City or San Francisco, where we would have cash burn so much money, we chose the Kansas City, so on the Missouri, on the cool part, okay? But that during that first year, we absolutely bet on US guys to sell to US customers, okay? Because that go-to-market team, that sales team, they were doing that huddle every morning. Do you really think that as a French female founder, I would have thought about doing an huddle, every day coming at the office? Absolutely no. So during this first year, you know, it's important to to be the big fish in town, go in an area where you can, you know, hire as much people as possible. So yeah, be creative on all this, and don't forget, so I know that lots of founders are so disappointed with PR, but don't forget that Bill Gates was saying that if he had only one penny to invest, he would invest in PR. Press relations are important. It has been important for us. Go to chase good PRs where it matters. For example, even if we were a French European company, we were not in the US in the first days, but we had a US PR agency. It was the only marketing budget we had, you know, in San Francisco. And because they were speaking, you know, writing about us, finally, European reporters wanted to, you know, interview us. And it, you know what, it's still working this way. So look at where your core activity is and try to chase those reporters, mostly in the US, unfortunately. But yes, this is important. And yeah, just remember that good things take time and be ready for the long run. So that picture, it's a BIME, you know, when we were in the US. But what I am proud of, you know, in this picture is that little kid, because don't forget to make babies, okay? During this first year, you know, this kid is staying, you know, that BIME office is not anymore in the US. It's been acquired by Zendesk, etc. But voilà, okay, so don't forget to make babies. And where to get good at during this first year, so where you have to really, improve yourself, it's about low signals. You know, low signals matter. So feel the low signals, or you have to put yourself in a position where you are taking the pulse of your churn customers at first, because it's so difficult to get a paid customer. Keep them happy, okay? It's so complicated. So be in a mode of, you know, capturing all those signals, and continue to be good at selling. The sooner you test your market, the best. People must buy the available version, okay? So it's referred to what I told you with product feedbacks. There will always be a roadmap to sell and to wait for and to perfectionate, etc. But you have to test your lead gen because it costs a lot. So the sooner you make mistakes, the best. And knowing that you are starting to sell, etc., you absolutely have to nail with the team who is starting to help you, you have to nail the commissioning structure. This is something that is coming, you know, I've seen, because I'm a business angel in many startups, etc. I'm seeing that questions of a commissioning structure, you know, coming far too late. And this is really something that you have to structure to get the smartest sales guys, because they won't come at yours if you are not fair and sophisticated also on this. Okay. So be careful about that. There is plenty of literature about it. And I'm not supposed to, you know, talk about to make the promotion of Salesforce or LinkedIn here, but because Salesforce is incredibly expensive, they are good, hein? But think about the future and when you will grow your company and when you will hire the best sales guys, they all want to work with Salesforce. Okay, so this, maybe I'm wrong, okay, but this is my experience, and I can tell you that I'm so happy to put all my CRM, all my data in Salesforce, because now that I am growing, I have all the historicals and all those great guys that are now joining. They are up and running with Salesforce. So Salesforce is good. Okay, a good CRM is good, but that reference is good. And LinkedIn, yes, abuse of LinkedIn. It's your cheapest, but you can also really nail it for your prospection matters. You also have to accept, and you have to get good at understanding that your customers may evolve, okay? The persona may evolve over time. And you know what? That's okay. That's completely okay. Completely okay. So don't force. Just be, you know, in a low signal capture mode, and that's okay. And it happens, I would say, in a majority of time. But when it comes to your team in general, what you have to get good at, it's everyone is telling you also to hire better, and oh yes, I have always hired better, but, you know, better than me as a founder, etc. Well, it's we know that it's super difficult to do so because of our egos or else, but you have really to fight against that and to for real, you know, to hire better than you and give them the keys. You have to give them the keys because if you want to grow, you definitely have to spread the workload. And you also have to understand how to fire ASAP, okay? How to fire ASAP. This is a key in your, during this where you have to get good at. And there is plenty, even in your first year, that's fine, to buy some software, you know, to help us to take the pulse of your team, you know, do the doing those 360. It's not only for very large companies, okay? You can do that, and the sooner you are doing this, the best, the better. I have personally massively invested, it's completely disproportionate, but I have massively invested in my HR team compared to my 80 plus people now. And I'm really happy of that because in this world, you know, in this hybrid remote world, it's super difficult to take the pulse of your company and be there. So yeah, this is what I have done and so far I am happy. And as I mentioned, you know, you really have to fire ASAP. You have to be transparent with as many people in your company as possible. And if you can't be transparent, maybe it's because you have to leave them out. During this first year also, what you have to be super good at, it's understanding your ASAP mechanism. Because you can have the surprise of having several rounds of fundings in a very short amount of time, all of them. So you have to think about your ESOP mechanism, how you will share the value of your company really early on, to not be surprised or to not be to please your salaries in the future. Definitely, you could raise much more earlier than expected. So it has to be super clean to make sure that everyone will be happy. And yeah, a good office is important, but I didn't put the shitty picture of my first office, but the former founder on this stage did, but it was a same battle, okay, so kind of. And yes, you have to be good at understanding that, make the most of your financial partners. You carefully picked them, because of the equity story, they are bringing more than money, etc. But understand that your financial partners are partners, okay? Do the WhatsApp thing, you know, be sure that you are, Marie Eklund, she's one of my founders, but we have very good relationship with all of them, and it has to be this way. And send love also during, be good at understanding that you have to send love to your co-founders, because no one is giving good feedbacks to co-founders, okay? No one. So if you are not you, the co-founders, giving them love, back, it's, and you have to over-celebrate, okay? But it's important to send some presents, you know. and as a personal, you know, founder, you definitely have to invest in your comfort a little bit. You can be creative for that, but for example, during my first company where we had absolutely no money, I was trying, you know, to save money on the lounge, you know, on good Wi-Fi, because it was costing, but it was such a bad decision, you know. Of course you need to sleep in a good hotel, of course you need a good Wi-Fi. Maybe it sounds crazy to say that, to save money on this, but many founders are doing so, and this is not smart at all. So yeah, don't save money in the wrong place, and don't add, you know, stuff, you know, to the pain, and try to be as good as you can, on everything. Try to be good enough on legal, on security, on finance, because you can't give all those keys, you know. It's important for your company. You can't give all those keys, you know, to outsourced people. And yes, so just try also during this first year to get good at some speaking slot, okay? You have to get out of your comfort zone for your resume speaker as well, for your team, you know, they are so glad when they see you, but it's coming with lots of stress, etc. I completely agree. And you have to get good at continue to make lots of babies, you know, so two of them, they are my kids in this Gitanos parking. But you have to be good at that, okay? So continue. And what to ignore, guys, so I'm almost done, but what to ignore? the noise of the competitions, okay? The noise of the competitions, because I love Ray Dalio, like many of you, but new is overvalued relative to great. You are not here to be freaked out by new competitions or always competitors. I am in carbon management space, okay? So every day they are popping up. But you know what? That's cool, at some point. And I don't care, I'm building something great, okay? So, voilà. And the noise of that competition, you know, it's you don't know what there is behind those super fundraising round of my competition or else. At some point, there is lots of cash out, so nothing is really going in the pocket of the company. You don't know what is behind all those news. So just move on, okay? And the noise of headlines, even if it's not your competitions, you know, we are seeing lots of headlines about, oh, they are far better than us, they are growing far better than us, et cetera, et cetera. Reporters love overnight success, but it's so exceptional. Do something great, and everyone was praising this guy. Look at the FTX guy. Look at what's happening today, so just move on as well. And also, ignore, please, the noise from VCs. Cher VC. So ignore the noise of VCs because you know what? Most of them, they are lazy. They are lazy people. They are not doing their homework. So they are counting on you guys to give them as much intel as possible about the market. They are lazy to deep dive into, okay? So be careful about that. They are using your time. They are even not paying you. You will have very few chance to get their money at the end. So move on as well. And build the list you want to have a relationship with and stick to it only, you know. So, and trust the one. And to build that list, actually, you know what? You remember the good lawyer, bad lawyer, there is good VCs, bad VCs. But to build that list, start with the ones who are giving back, okay? Who are giving you intel as well. And there is very, very few ones. VCs again. Just ignore some of them. They are trying to ask you to scout. Okay, in English, scout. What the fuck, quoi? It's okay. It's a fantastic defocus. How can they dare to ask you this while you are building a business? Okay, so ignore that first. Run fast. And again, you know, focus on what matters. This is my first kid. Make more babies, you know, and ignore your company, actually. At some point, ignore your company. Everything can fail. There is crisis everywhere, etc. But at least you have your kids, you have your husband, okay? Everyone is talking about securing, the Sequoia partner was talking about, oh, you can secure your girlfriend, okay? I secured my boyfriend also, you know? So, okay, so, but you can build your, you build your family, maximize your personal growth. And just ignore also this presentation, okay? This presentation, guys, okay? Go back to work also. And trust yourself, you know your stuff more than anyone else. Don't think that I can give you the best advice, etc. There is patterns, okay, definitely, but you know your stuff more than anyone else. Don't be hard on yourself as well, and be responsible. Please do not start the next Shein, you know, the fast fashion thing. You are building companies now in a world where you have to be responsible. So good luck to all of you. Do care about the planet, please, of course. And if you don't know where to start, you can assess your carbon, if your company is on track with its carbon or not, you know, with this QR code. So merci beaucoup. Good luck to everyone. You are doing great, definitely. And don't forget about all this. Bye-bye. Salut.